Welcome to Great Lakes Church. It is such an honor to have you here with us. If you don't know who we are, we're a community of people in Southeast Wisconsin looking to make life a little bit easier. It's no surprise that knowing how to do the right thing or choosing the right path in our relationships or even just getting started in following Jesus can be hard. So we're aiming to make it a little easier by being here for you along the way. If you want to know more about who we are, what we do, and why we do it, you can head to greatlakeschurch.com or download the Great Lakes Church app wherever you have your app store. But in the meantime, we hope this talk encourages you to take the next step in your personal life, your relationships, or your spiritual journey. Enjoy.
Back in my 20-ish years, like later 20s, when I was first on my own, all I really cared about was saving money, like a lot of us do, mostly because I didn't have a lot of money. So when it came to television, which was near and dear to my heart and an integral part of just my everyday life, I needed to find the cheapest option. And so I landed on this thing called DirecTV. And this is a satellite, if you're not familiar with, that sometimes shuts the lights off, but eventually the lights come back on, and it's a really good thing. But the other thing that happens a lot is it stops working, and you will be watching television, and you will have this frustrating message that comes up on the screen. It's S0A00. All the time, this comes up. Usually right before something important happens in the game, just before the big reveal in the show, just before the big bus moves and they see the house for the first time, that's when this message comes up. It's a pull your hair out kind of moment. It's a scream at the TV and say words you shouldn't say in front of your children when that screen comes up. And I tried everything, every time to fix it, but it inevitably ended up with a phone call to customer service, which always meant a long wait. And then the person would come on all chipper as if they hadn't made me just sit on the phone for an hour. How can I help you? Well, I have this error message on my television, S0A00. I have no idea what that means, sir. I'm like, but you're supposed to be the expert. Yes, and I'm going to help you find a solution to this. And you can hear them flipping through the guidebook. Have you heard this, felt this before? But then that customer service agent asked me what I considered to be the most insulting question ever. Sir, is your television plugged in? Bro, I'm telling you the error message that's on my television. Yes, it's plugged in. And my feelings are a little hurt that you think I would call you not having my television and the box plugged in, just in case you thought that would be an option. His response was, you'd be surprised. And then he dropped a line that has hung with me ever since that conversation. He said, sir, sometimes complex problems have simple solutions. Of all people, a DirecTV customer service representative dropped a wisdom grenade on my lap, and I had to figure out what to do with it. Sometimes complex problems have really simple solutions. And what I love about that is it just reminds me of all of the time and energy that I have wasted trying to solve a complex problem with a complex solution. Because I always assume it's got to be complex, especially when it comes to technology and all of those kinds of things. And you know what I'm realizing the older I get and the more often that my children fix the technological problem for me? I don't want it to be a simple solution. Because if it's a simple solution, then I feel like I must be simple. Like I'm not smart enough to have figured it out. I'm not mature enough to have figured it out. I'm not wise enough to have figured it out. Like I need it to be complex because then at least it's excusable that I didn't know what to do. This happens a lot in my life. I don't want it to be too crystal clear what the obvious answer was, because what does that say about me? Now that dilemma, that question, that wrestling so feeds into what it means to be a Christian these days. And Christians are really, really good at complicating things. And we want this thing that we call Christianity or following Jesus or our faith to be complex. Because if it's simple, then people might think we're simple. If it's too easy, then people are going to think we're too childish. If it's easy to understand, then we're not deep enough. And the list goes on and on. So we introduce all kinds of twists and turns and layers and sequences and scopes, and this is how you mature and become more like Jesus. And we do things like classes and courses and books, and we created whole colleges for Christians and all of these kinds of things because it needs to be that. For us to feel like we are being taken seriously, we need those things. And yet, a lot of us have spent a lot of time following Jesus frustrated because we don't feel it. There's something in us that's just kind of going, ugh. I'm doing this. I'm showing up at church. I might even read the verse of the day on the Bible app. I do the things. I go to Bible studies. I've been to Bible studies. I visited a lady today. Her daughter said she's been to 80,000 Bible studies. I think she was exaggerating. But I'm standing there going, this is a holy woman. That's what went off in my mind. The more Bible studies, the more books, the more classes, the more memorization, the better Christian we are. If that's the case, why would we ever end up feeling frustrated or like something's missing or like we're not feeling it? And I wonder if sometimes God looks at us and goes, is it plugged in? Because you are looking for a very complex solution to a very complex God. But what's so amazing about him is he made it very simple. Here's the reality that I have tried to settle into lately. Being like Jesus is really hard. It's really hard. Like, we need to stop pretending it's easy. And part of the reason it's hard is because, I'm going to say this, I don't know that you can. Not if we understand who Jesus fully is. Now, we will strive and we will do our best and we will be striving our whole life. But when we sit down and we understand the gravity of who Jesus is, just how great and awesome he is, we understand it's a very complex God that we're following. Luckily, he made the solution, the way, simple, but let's make sure we understand the context. This is how John records it in his biography of Jesus. Jesus knew that the Father had given him authority over some things. No. Jesus has been given the authority over everything. Now, can you think of one thing that's not a part of everything? Neither can I. Everything is an all-inclusive term. So literally anything that exists, anything that you and I can look at, sense, touch, smell, Jesus has authority over all of it. When we were kids, we would say, he's the boss of it. all of existence falls under Jesus' authority and rule. Isn't it interesting then that we say things like, Jesus is my homeboy? Do we know who we're talking about? Do we know who we're dealing with here? This is God himself. I mean, that statement alone tells us Jesus is God because God has authority over all things. And then Paul comes along and he writes his letter to the Philippians, and this is what he said. God gave him the name above all other names, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow. Do you know anybody else who would ever come close to having that said about them? Every knee, every most powerful person in the world, every celebrity, every boss, every subordinate, everybody at the top of the food chain all the way to the bottom of the food chain, influential people and people who nobody knows their name, every single knee bows at the name of Jesus. That's power. That is God and God alone. I can't think of any other name that's part of any other name when Paul is saying all of them fall under his. Sometimes my imagination gets going, and can you imagine with me for just a minute what it would be like if we literally practiced this and every time anybody heard the name Jesus, we all bowed our knee? That's reverence. That's a complex God. Now, here's how I've come to grips with this. I have no stinking idea how an iPhone works. Do you? I mean, we walk around with these little things in our pockets, and they do incredible things. Think about this. The computer you had when you were a child. Some of you are going, I didn't have a computer when I was a child. It's okay. Like, this does more than any full desktop computer that existed 10 years ago. In your pocket, you have a camera. You have a telephone. You have an emailing messaging system. You have a scanner. You have a camera. You have, well, let me tell you about all the other things. You have a word processor. You have a way to connect with all your friends through social media. You have a work messaging app. You have file storage on your phone. You can shop from your phone anywhere you go. And oh, by the way, now we have headphones that have no wire connected to it, and you can hear it. Can anyone begin to understand how a cellular phone, a mobile device, a smartphone works? No, none of us can. But what's so amazing about the companies that make them is they take all of that grand technology and they cram it in and they make it in such a way that you and I can use it. It's approachable. And my 11-year-old son does not need an instruction manual to operate it when he turns it on. This is what the gift of Jesus is. All of the things that we do not understand and cannot understand about God somehow got crammed down into God in a body, Jesus himself, and made it approachable. Made him approachable. And there's this one moment in the life and ministry of Jesus, in his friendship with his disciples, where he does something that not only makes him approachable, but takes it down a few notches from there. And he becomes a servant. It's not long before his death. We'll pick up right here. He got up. Jesus got up from the table, took off his robe, wrapped a towel around his waist, and poured water into a basin. It says, then he began to wash the disciples' feet, drying them with the towel he had around him. As we talk about this, do not lose sight of the great description that we just read about this Jesus. the name that every knee should bow to, the one who has authority over all things. He has put a towel around his waist. He has bent down, and he is doing what is reserved for not just the servants, but the lowest of the servants. Like, there's a hierarchy with the people that work in the houses back then. If you had seniority, you might work from the kitchen, but if you were new and you were low on the totem pole, you were the foot washer. That was your job. And that's what Jesus is doing? Now, I don't want to over-romanticize this, because this is what we tend to do in Christianity. Understand, these feet were filthy. These were men that had walked around for days barefoot through mud and puddles that had stuff in it, in and out of the sea, sweat in the heat, sand. They didn't know what a pumice cube was back then. Don't ask me how I know. These were gross. Fingernails long, sticking out. Imagine the smell. 12 guys and their gross feet. And the God of the universe, whose name is above all other names, who has authority over all things that exist, who created the men whose feet he's washing. That's crazy. That's totally crazy. And we're supposed to be like him. This is what Jesus says. Do you understand what I was doing when I was washing your feet? You call me teacher and Lord, and you're right, because that's what I am. But then he goes on to say this: and since I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you ought to wash each other's feet. He says, I have given you an example to follow. Do as I have done to you. I tell you the truth, slaves are not greater than their master. Wait a minute, Jesus. You're supposed to be the king that conquers, and we're supposed to be your main people. And Jesus says, yeah, you are, and I am, but we're not doing it how you think we're doing it. Jesus says, if you want to follow me, you need to, his words are, do as I have done. There's action in that word, do as I have done. What are the things that Jesus has done? Most people will say literally he's washed feet. So a lot of times if you grew up in the church, especially in youth group, there was always this moment at camp where the youth pastor would wash the kids' feet and it was hyper emotional. Personally, I don't think Jesus is saying literally go wash feet. I think he's saying look at the whole of who I am and all of the things that I've done. All of the ways that I've served you and the people that you and I have been around. Do that. If you want to know how to be like me, if you want to know how to follow me, if you want to know how to mature in your faith and see your Christianity, your following Jesus matter, you have to do as Jesus did. You have to see others as Jesus sees others. And Jesus would go on to say, I didn't come to be served. I came to serve. So here's what this means as Jesus followers and as a church in 2024. What would we say? This is how I would put it. We're never more like Jesus than when we serve someone else. We're never more like Jesus than when we serve another person. You see, I grew up thinking I was more like Jesus the more I went to Bible study. I grew up thinking I was more like Jesus the more I went to church, the more I gave, the more I volunteered, the more I did these other things that are easy to check off. But I'm settling into the idea being like Jesus is really just about serving other people. Because that's what he said he came to do. And that's what he did do. So he took this grand idea of following God and he made it really simple and user-friendly, a way that you and I could approach being like Jesus that is so difficult because he's who he is. He just said, follow me, serve others, love others. And then as Jesus is telling Paul everything he needs to know for Paul to go out and start helping the churches get started, eventually leading to us being here in this day and age, this is what Paul would write. He says, as slaves of Christ, do the will of God with all your heart. Work with enthusiasm as though you were working for the Lord rather than for people. That has a lot to say about how you do your job. Parents, that has a lot to say about how you interact with your children when you're folding laundry and doing dishes. That has a lot to say about when our neighbor obviously needs a hand. What does it look like for us to help and to serve as if we were doing that for Jesus? It changes everything about the way I do it. I don't just get the job done because I'm doing this for the King. I'm gonna do it to the very best of my ability. And I would do anything for Jesus, right? I mean, I don't think anybody would argue if Jesus himself walked into the building physically and he said, can somebody just wash my feet? We'd all go, I'll do it, gladly. Please, let me. None of us would even hesitate. So what if instead of saying, hey, we're gonna serve other people in spite of them, like this is kind of how we operate. I'm going to serve you despite the way you treat me and in spite of who you are and your character and all those things, you know, because that's what I'm supposed to do and I want to be able to check the box. We might go a step better and we say, in light of who I am, right? Like that we shift it over to us and say, well, I'm a follower of Jesus. I'm a good Christian. So I'm going to do this thing again so that I can feel good. All of a sudden, is that really serving anybody but us? What Jesus would say, if you want to be like me, here's how you do it. You do it as if you are me for me. You serve other people as if you are Jesus in the flesh to them because you're trying to be like me, but you're also going to see them as if they were me because you will give them your very best and you will do anything for me. That messes with my head. I kind of wish he hadn't said it. Because it pulls any excuse and any roadblock and any attitude that I can introduce to the equation, it pulls it right back out of it. I don't have any room to wiggle in there. And you're going, wait a minute, we haven't even heard that yet. Where are you getting this? Do it as if I was him for him. Well, we got the as if I was him part. But here is what Jesus says where I get the for him part. For I was hungry and you fed me. I was thirsty and you gave me a drink. I was a stranger and you invited me into your home. He keeps going. He says, I was naked and you gave me clothing. I was sick and you cared for me. I was in prison and you visited me. And the next part is the part that we would all understand. It says, then these righteous ones will reply, Lord, when? And in the scriptures, it goes on to say, when did we do all of those things that you just named? And the King will say, I tell you the truth. When you did it to one of the least of these, my brothers and sisters, you were doing it for me. When we talk about serving others, it's not because it's a nice thing to do as kind of the side hustle of our Christianity, the side hustle of our faith. It's central to our faith. Jesus can't use words like this and say things like this and us just go, sounds really nice, and I'm still going to focus on the things that make me feel like I'm progressing and I'm getting there. I had lunch with somebody today and he said something so great that eventually I got to get him to turn it into a book. He said, we shouldn't make Jesus our goal, we need to make him the center. Because when he's the center, he's infused into everything and influences everything, no matter which way we move. And that's what Jesus is saying here. Everything you do, do it as if you were doing it for me, because you are. We're never more like Jesus than when we serve someone else. We're never closer to Jesus than when we serve someone else. This is what it means to follow in his footsteps. And what's so great about this idea is it's portable. We can take this wherever we go. It's not dependent on a church building. It's not dependent on having certain books with you all the time. It's not dependent on you being able to spout off a bunch of verses and things like that. You can do this anytime, anywhere. So we use this language a lot. You can serve here and be growing in your faith. You can also serve near, because you can take this with you out into the community in which you live, the community in which we operate. And even if you get on an airplane and you fly down to Honduras or you fly to Africa or you go wherever you go for business, you can serve far. And anywhere and everywhere you go, you are being like him, because no matter where, here, near, or far, you are serving the King. This is Christianity. Is it all of it? Probably not. Is it the lion's share? I think so. And if we got this right, and we focused on this, and we were locked into this, other things might start to just feel right. So, here's what I'm proposing we do in the days ahead. Do something beneath you. If every knee should bow at the name of Jesus, then what Jesus did was he brought his knee lower than the lowered knee. So what does it look like for you and I to find something that we could offer someone else that feels, at least on the surface, like it's beneath us? Because washing his followers, his students' feet was way beneath Jesus. That's what Peter said in the moment. You can't wash my feet. You're my teacher. You're my master, my savior. Jesus says, but this is what it is. So find something beneath you, find something for someone else, and do all of it in service to the King. A lot of times when people are looking for churches or they're looking to get more involved in a church, they come with a lot of questions ready to fire off at people like me or our board or other staff members, questions that deserve an answer, but are usually very predictable. And one of the more predictable ones that we hear and that you might even ask, and it's fair to ask, like I said, is what's your discipleship model? Now, discipleship is a tricky word, and we don't say this in any other context except in the church. Discipleship is becoming like someone else. So if you are a disciple of someone, you are saying, I want to think like them, talk like them, do like them, move like them, be just like them. I want to become a carbon copy of them. So when we say things like, I'm a disciple of Jesus, we're saying, I'm trying to become like him, which is different than knowing a lot about him. It's becoming like him. So here's my answer to this question. What's our discipleship model? Serve. This is what we do to become more like Jesus. We serve other people because that's what Jesus did. That's what Jesus said we should do. Now, here's the good news. There are countless opportunities and ways for you to serve right here, here, near, and far. And if you're interested in taking that step, we have a special spot in our lobby where you can go and get all the information you might need about what does it look like for you to start serving others through your church. We call it the Big Step Center. It's the big blue wall out in the lobby, and there's a desk in front of it, and there's usually, we try to always have somebody there where you go, hey, here's kind of how I'm wired up. Here's the things I'd be interested in doing. We've got a great place for you to serve. But I know that's a big jump. That's a big commitment. That's a difficult promise to make. So here's what's cool. We have an opportunity coming up in the next month where it's a one-night commitment for you to serve, and it's a near serving. It's for our community. Our friends at Jockey are putting on a concert, and they need volunteers. They need volunteers to help with parking. They need volunteers to help with tickets and taking them. They need help with helping people find their seats. And all of this is for kids in foster care and kids that are going through adoption, all this kind of stuff. It's a great, great way to serve our community and serve our kids. Our students are going to go. They're going to get tickets and go and be a part of it as well. But such a cool place for you and me as people who are just looking to be like Jesus, take one small step. So here's the deal. If you are interested in this, you're just going to go to the Big Steps table too. It's in February on the 22nd. It's a one-night commitment, and it's super, super simple. An easy way for you to go, I love my community. I love Jesus. I want to be like Jesus, so I'm going to do this small thing for my community. And what I promise you is if you, whether you commit to serving here at the church or you commit to serving this way, you give it time. At the end of it, you're going to go, that was a good night. That was a good thing. I feel something in this following Jesus because we're never more like him than when we serve someone else. I'm going to pray, and then the board's going to come out, and we'll talk for a couple extra minutes, if you could hang tight. Heavenly Father, thank you for being so gracious that you took all of the complexity that is you, and you made it approachable, and you made it possible for us to follow in Jesus, and that his instructions were so clear, and they weren't overly complex. It was do like I do. And here's what I'm doing. I'm serving other people. All the way to the cross was a service to us. So help us to pursue that as we attempt to be more like you. We know that we'll never really get there this side of eternity. But we will try harder every single day to bend the knee at the name of Jesus and serve our neighbor. We love you. Thank you for loving us. In Jesus' name, amen.
If we've never met before, my name's Justin. I've had the pleasure to serve on the board here and over the last 15 years. And there has been no greater litmus test for our collective capacity and resilience. If you just look at our last year, we were able to transition a loved leader in Racine to a place that he's thriving now. We had to make some really hard choices on our campus strategy that affect so many of you that are from Racine. We come to find out late in the year that our lead pastor who founded this place is obeying God into another calling and loved him well into it, all while not having the leader of our place in place. And then you got to hear from a whole bunch of new faces that have been around for a while, but they've never had to be the face of a decision. And I know minds and hearts were swirling on who are these people? Will they commit? Will they make their promises come true? And if they do, who would that next leader look like? And will we even recognize this place? So I just want to say thank you. On behalf of the church, this leadership team, for believing in us, allowing today to be a major update in that pastoral search and giving us the room and the process to interview 5 incredible potential leaders. But today, we get to tell you who our leader is. And instead of just telling you who he was and why we picked him, there was this moment in the interview process where Doug Cunliffe-Owen, who has served on stewardship for almost 10 years, and you see him almost weekly with his wife in the coffee area, had this really cool question that he asked our next lead pastor, which is just a glimpse in one of the reasons, and one of the many reasons we as a team have the confidence in who our next leader is, who he will be, and ultimately how God through him will lead us into our next chapter. Check this out.
And I've heard him say this before, that GLC is a church that he would attend if he were looking for a church. And it really comes down to that environment where grace is lived out, and much of that has to do with culture. How do we protect the culture while at the same time growing and discipling and still maintain that it factor?
Yeah, it's a really good question. And if we figure it out, we should write a book. What worked so well for GLC for the first 15 years is that the founding pastor was, he was the culture. Dave was the culture. When I see clips of his, especially his earlier sermons, talks, I know we don't call them sermons, but even like right there, like let's be careful about the language we use. That's one thing. But Dave just was willing to say what everybody was thinking. He was willing to be hyper vulnerable. So anytime whoever's on the platform is readily willing to say, I'm imperfect and here's how, I think that communicates to everybody, I don't have to be perfect to come here. And it makes the people who think they are perfect pretty uncomfortable there, and they will probably deselect. There's already been a couple moments where that's happened for me, where not that I was drifting away from it, but I realized there are people who are going to do a really good job of protecting it and championing it. One was just with Justin. I was in a Zoom meeting with him like this. I was wearing a hat, a ball cap, and he said, I love that hat. You should preach in that hat. I wouldn't have thought to ever preach in a hat. I grew up in a church where you just didn't do that. But it was this moment where I'm like, oh, that's okay. Yeah, that's fine. His line to me was, you can wear whatever you want, just wear something. And so what was amazing was that Sunday, I had a mother come up to me in tears saying, thank you for wearing a hat today. My son wore a hat to church, and I told him, you can't wear a hat to church. And he said, if I can't wear a hat at church, I don't want to go to that church. And he walked in and saw the guy teaching in a hat. That was really good. And then I'm not saying this because Grogan's on the call. I'm saying it because it was really, really helpful. We went out after a Wednesday night when he was in town, and he was talking to me about my message. And he said, the only thing is, where were you in that talk? And it was meaningful. I made it a huge adjustment between Wednesday and Sunday because I realized I wasn't being very vulnerable in the talk. I wasn't sharing how I've struggled with it, which is a value of mine in any talk, but I just kind of missed it in that one. So I think what's beautiful about the GLC culture is, it's even though it would be easy to think it was just Dave, he passed that on to so many people that they do it without even realizing they're doing it.
Great Lakes Church, it's my honor to invite the next lead pastor of Great Lakes Church, Josh Petersen.
I'm supposed to talk now. There are ways that over the course of the next few months that you will learn from me how God has healed and inspired and reminded me who he is through you. That God is the only rational explanation for this. And there are a lot of times in my life where I have attributed what's going on in my life to his providence. And most people would say it's an irrational answer, but I don't care who you are. This time, it's the only one. The fact that my kid's grade school gym teacher was the one that mentioned my name to Dave, and all of it snowballed from there, is proof. And I could not be more humbled or honored or excited or proud to be part of this community. And I'll never forget when I saw a leadership transition happen at another church, what was said that day, and so I'm just going to steal it. The leadership of Great Lakes Church is not changing, because the leader's always been Jesus. So we're just going to follow his lead still. And so I'm beyond excited. I'm beyond grateful that you've invited me to this place. And I love you with all my heart. And we're going to see God do some crazy, crazy things in the future.
I love that Josh is our champion. He's our face of our vision. But catch what he said. Jesus has always led this thing. And to that effect, we are inviting Josh, and he has accepted the lead person as part of the collective group of people that for the last 15 years and the foreseeable future as we go forward will continue to be the place where people help people find and follow Jesus. God's not done writing our story, and he's not done writing your story either. Here's the deal. If we would have told anybody what we have been through as a church over the last year, every expert would have told you that what I'm about to tell you, what we're about to tell you, wouldn't be possible. Our weekly attendance, on average, has grown to the point where if we make this opportunity to invite over the next 52 weeks, we knew we were going to need more seats. So what did we do? We asked you to let us start a third service. And what did you say? Let's go for it. We need more seats. On our weekends on Wednesday, we wanted to love kids there too, so more people could show up there and students. So we needed more volunteers. And what did you do? You said, let's do this thing. If I were just to look at this last Christmas season, we broke attendance records. Josh, what else? If we just looked at the last Christmas season.
You know, we've been talking a lot about Christmas offering over the last couple months. And for those of you that don't understand how that works around here, usually we take the last portion of the year and anything above and beyond normal operating expenses, we give away. We don't hold on to it. And so people show up and give way beyond what they would normally give. And we set, I'll just say, a stupid goal.
Stupid goal.
Stupid goal.
Because we shouldn't ask you to do something in a season of transition when you can't look at it and say, here's the stability.
Yeah, no, any expert would have said, setting a $250,000 goal for a giving offer, for a Christmas offering in this year
is stupid.
Is stupid. And it's only setting you and your church up for failure and disappointment. But something kind of cool happened. So we want to tell you what the number actually was, and it was not zero. So here we go.
We'll be right back.
God's more stupid.
I'm glad you said that, not me.
They can fire me. Listen, in so many pivotal seasons as a church, we have embraced a phrase that the best is yet to come. And here's all that means in this season. I think it's so appropriate for us as a church. We have so much more to build, to be a part of.
And to celebrate.
To party and to be hopeful for, because here's all I want you to know. We have a bright future full of opportunities to be light in all the places God has given us influence. And so today, because of God, through Jesus, he continues to write not just your story, but our story for one clear outcome, his glory, our good. At this time, I want to invite the board up, some of the stewardship members up. We're going to pray with Josh for our church, for our staff, for all of us. And while they're coming up, Josh, will you tell us who's on the screen?
Man, I wasn't going to cry at all. Those are my heroes. In a lot of ways, those are my role models. And they're my support. And it was easy for me to say yes, because they said yes too. I had a little deal with God. I'm not doing this unless my boys are on board. And they said, Dad, please do it. We're with you. So, yeah. So starting from your right, that's me. Then next is my son, Jake. He's my oldest, my firstborn, 20 years old, which is really weird to say. Next is the youngest, that's Sawyer. He is 11, and he's a party waiting to happen. Next is Logan. He's 15. And then Cole is 13. And they love Great Lakes. My favorite story to tell you is a couple weeks ago when I was heading up here for a board meeting on a Thursday night, they could not understand why they couldn't come. Because if we're going to Great Lakes, everybody wants to come. And that is because of you. You have made my sons feel so at home, so loved, and so seen. That is such a gift to them and to me as their dad. So thank you from the bottom of my heart for welcoming this whole circus into your family. We love it and we're grateful.
Let's pray. God, we just pause and express the sense of awe. I personally love watching these historical videos taking us back 15 years of Great Lakes Church history, and we could not have scripted the twists and turns. But looking back, we see that your hand has guided us and held us up, and it's just amazing. And we are entering a new chapter of Great Lakes history. We are just immensely proud that you have put an enormous spotlight and made the decision incredibly easy for us at the board and stewardship team to select Josh. And we pray for Josh. We pray that his ministry here be one of just enormous blessing to himself, to the rest of the church as we carry out your mission. We also want to pray for his family. His family is now part of our family. His boys and an extended family. We just want to also pray for the church staff. We pray that everyone is fully on board and embracing this mission. We pray for extra boldness as we reach out to friends and family, neighbors, coworkers, and we invite one. And we all believe the best is yet to come. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
I've seen a lot of tears, a lot of clapping of hands, a lot of celebration. So here's the thing. Over the last several months, God's grace and the pouring out of love and support have just been joyfully overwhelming. And so we didn't want to miss this moment for all of us to take a second, relax, reflect, and take it all in. And so while this next song plays, give yourself the space to absorb it all. And towards the end of it, there will be some instructions on the screen on how you can engage with that brown tag that you saw on the seat when you came in and what to do with it. Check this out.
Got nothing new. How could I express all my gratitude? I could sing these songs as I often do, but every song must end. So I throw in my eyes, praise you again and again. So did I have his hallelujah, hallelujah. I know it's not much, about nothing else fit for a king, set for hearts singing hearts. Got one response, I've got just one move. With my arms stretched wide, yeah, I will worship you, yeah. So I throw up my hands, praise you again and again. 'Cause all that I have is a heart. I'm nothing else.
Thanks for trusting us with some of your time today. We hope that whether you are finishing a workout, wrapping up your commute, or maybe sitting on the couch in a comfortable space with someone you care about, that you can walk away with something. Take an action step in your faith journey. And then if you find yourself in the Southeast Wisconsin area, come join us at our Kenosha campus. Until then, you can find out a ton more about what we do and get more messages at greatlakeschurch.com or in the Great Lakes Church app. My name is Carson, and I'm so glad you're here. We'll look forward to seeing you next week.